right. My name is Esther Finder. Today is January 24th, 1996. We are interviewing Rena Kornreif Gelissen in Columbia, Maryland, in the USA, and the language is English. Today is January 24th, 1996. My name is Esther Finder. We are interviewing Rena Kornreif Gelissen. We are in Columbia, Maryland, and the language will be English.
Yeah.
Right. I'd like to start the interview today by thanking you for your willingness to speak with us today. Would you please state your name?
Rena Gelissen. R-E-N-A G-E-L-I-S-S-E-N.
What was your name at birth?
At birth, the last name, Kornreich, K-O-R-N-R-E-I-C-H.
Okay. And what's your birthday?
See, I'm already nervous. My birthday is August 24, 1920.
And how old are you? How old are you today?
I'm today 75 years old and a couple of months.
Where were you born?
I was born in Tillich, little town, it's a little town that was called, in the Carpathian Mountains in the south of Poland. And the Tillich is spelled T-Y-L-I-C-Z, Tillich.
Can you tell me a little bit about what your town was like?
They were living, after World War I, some Ruthenians. Encyclopedia calls them Ruthenians, so I call them to. They were not exactly Russians, they weren't Ukrainians. They call them Ruthenians, so I call them to. They spoke the Russian language, and they used the Russian alphabet for their for writing, okay? And then they were, all together, there were 5,000 people in Tillich. And the majority was Polish Catholic, and the other one was Greek Orthodox, the Russians, and there were 25 Jewish families, Orthodox Jewish families. All 25 families. And the town was mostly farmers, the Gentiles and some of the Jews. My family, the Kornreichs, two brothers, had farms, both of them. They were for many years in the Kornreichs in Tillich, and they bought land, and they was going from father to son and then to grandson and so forth. And we still had the small farm.
Can you tell me about your family?
The family. Well, when I was growing up, where do I start with the family, with any time? It was all together, it was seven children, okay? And before World War I, a little girl was born but died as an infant. Then was born another two girls 2 years apart, Gertrude and Zosia. I knew exactly the year when it was, but I probably won't remember now. I know she was 16 years older than I, so 16 years before me. And Zosia was, 2 years later, Zosia was born. So World War I came. There were two girls, World War I, Gertrude and Zosia. And during World War I, two boys were born. But I think it's the influenza, what it was at this time there. It was all over the world, actually, the influenza. And the two boys died before there was a chance to get them some medication. And then 1920, after the war, 2 years, and I was born. And 2 years later, 1922, my sister Danka was born.
Can you tell me about your parents?
My parents were Jewish Orthodox, very religious, and my mother was born in Czechoslovakia, married very young, I think 17 or 18, and my father was born in Tillich, and he was a yeshiva buche, I don't know how to say that, to yeshiva was going in Czechoslovakia. And it was an arranged marriage, and they were a very happy couple. And it was a loving, lovely, wonderful family. And all the 25 families, Jewish, lived with the Gentiles, the Ruthenians, and the Polish people in peace and harmony. We didn't know ecumenical, the word ecumenical, what it meant, but we lived by it. So I didn't know really much about anti-Semitism or any harsh things about it during the life when I was growing up. And then the Greek Orthodox had their own school, and the Polish school was for the Polish children, and the Jewish children attended the Polish public school 7 years. And what else was she like? We didn't have a rabbi in the town, but we had a shochet, which is a ritual study, and he was trained, he was studied to be a rabbi. To, he knew to pask and shalas, to say, you know, that means in Hebrew, pask and shalas means in Jewish, means that if there's something wrong with the animal that was slaughtered, to give an example on a chicken or a goose, the liver had spots or something, you would go to him asking, is it kosher or not? If it's not, then you throw it out. So that was the shechet, and his name was Bleich. And then there was a cheder, there was a malamet, a teacher, and in the temple, in the same room there, was the, were the children studying every day from first grade, usually. But I started to go to cheder. They were only for boys. But my mom insisted that she wants her daughter to study Hebrew too. So she talked to the Jewish community, and they finally, after a lot of troubles, they allowed one girl. So there's a big room, the temple room, and there's a long table, and boys are sitting on long benches on two sides of the table. And another long table, one little girl is sitting studying, and the Rebbe was splitting himself between the studies for the boys, which they were studying Torah and everything else. I was studying just Hebrew, to be able to read Hebrew and to translate a little bit only, like the prayers for the Sabbath or something, the Chedres it's called, which Seder is this week. From their studying, I listened a lot. They were allowed practicing, so I could I learned that too. But mostly it was writing and reading the Hebrew. And then my mother decided that I'm sitting a lot of time while he was busy with the boys, and it was a lot longer. And I'm not, the boys are studying and practicing right there in the temple. Do you know any other language? She asked him to teach my daughter. She says, yes, I know German. So he taught me German and Hebrew at the same time. And while I was going to school, to the Polish school, the Polish public school decided, so long as we have Ruthenians in town, the children, all the Polish and Jewish children should know the language too and the alphabet. So in first grade, we started with the alphabet, Polish and Ruthenian, and I had the Hebrew and German at 7 years, four languages, and Jewish at home. So it's four languages, and the fifth one was at home. The other languages I learned later.
Can you tell me about religious observances in your town?
Well, I don't know if you know about Hasidic Jews. Everything is observed like on the Sabbath, not to do anything. I mean, you fed the animals because that was necessary if you had a farm like we did, but no cooking. So we had a big oven at the shochets at the rabbi's home, and you brought a chulent you made. You made it on Friday, and you brought it on the afternoon late to the home there. And his daughter Golda was waiting for us and put it all in the oven. There was already prepared oven with the coals. It burned the wood, and then the coals spread apart. And by Sabbath morning, they went all to prayers. The little girls, the young girls didn't go, so I didn't, only on holidays, on New Year's, and Rosh Hashanah, and Yom Kippur for a little while only. And then on the Sabbath, you would go over, after the parents came home, we would go over and bring the children home, and we had lunch. And in the morning, we had for coffee to warm up, which mother prepared the day before, we had a Gentile woman coming in, and she would light a fire and it was heated the coffee. And during the war, we weren't allowed to have Gentile help, so we didn't have anything warm Saturday morning. The most of them, or all of them as far as I know, refused to light the fire themselves. So they rather went without.
When you were growing up, what did you do for fun?
For fun. We played dominoes in the evening. We played cards. On some holidays and Purim, or the ones we had the dry girl that we played for games to win. You win if it's a Shein or whatever it is. I don't know if you're familiar with it. And reading, lots of reading. So there was the school library, and there was my lay teacher. As I said, one of them was a non-teaching, and one of them in the public school. And one of them was a non and one lay teacher. And the lay teacher, Miss Bochinska was her name. She had a private library herself. And so I was allowed, some students were, and I was sort of a little bit helper of the teacher. I helped her carry the books home. And then I had the privilege to hang around a little bit longer and look in the library what books I wanted. And she decided which one was suitable for me and which wasn't, maybe, I don't know. But she said this one or this one. If I picked it, she said, yes, that's a historical roman, that's okay. Except my father didn't think it was okay. So he took it away from me and said, absolutely not. It was history, but in the history was a love story there too, and I wasn't supposed to read it. So reading, a lot of reading with it. So my sister and I, and all the other children too. And then we played ball outside and throwing the ball and walking in the summer, mountain climbing and walking, because we lived in the mountains, like in North Carolina where I live now. And what else would you like to know?
Tell me about your social life as you were growing up.
Well, the social life was the 25 families. There were weddings, bar mitzvahs, births, pidina bens after the, what is the first one called? Can't think of the name when the circumcision takes place. Pidina ben is later, a month later, but the circumcision.
A bris.
The bris and the pidina ben later on, I think it's a month later. And all the families, there were never any invitations sent away. Everybody attended everybody's simcha. You know what simcha is? So the holy, anything that we celebrated, all of us celebrated together. So this was a lot of fun too. By Purim, for example, for the holiday, everybody was baking the best cookies that they knew how, and you're sending shlechmunes, it's called, from one house to the other one. So usually the little children, either a boy or a girl, we didn't have boys, so the girls were doing a plate with your own home-baked cookies and covered with a nice doily, and you were bringing it to all the people, wherever mom decided to go to bring it, and they gave the children some money. So you ended up with a pocket full of money after this, and mom baked the cookies for it. And every family to other families, so they had a lot of cookies from everybody else, and they had for months probably cookies there. And what else did we do for fun? As I said, walking, mountain climbing, and some of them that knew how, they were going to swimming too. Mostly the boys, but there was a swimming pool in a little town nearby, but there was mixed swimming, so I wasn't allowed, so I don't know how to swim till this day. We, the Hasidic Jews, the children, the girls weren't allowed in mixed swimming pools. So we didn't learn to swim, but the boys could swim at all time. And fishing, that's right. Yeah, I forgot about that. Most of the boys were fishing for the Shabbos, for fish, to have on Friday night, to have the fish, and to have it for the Sabbath. And there wasn't always enough money. We all not always had the chance to go to another town. 5 kilometers from our 7 kilometers, 5 miles, approximately between 4 and 5 miles, to that on to buy the fish. So we were fishing. The boys were fishing to have, and we didn't have any boys. So I wanted to go and bring the fish in too, and I had to pay my way in. My mother was baking Friday morning. Usually we're doing it. My mother was baking cheese Danish in the morning. If I had cheese Danish with me, and I had for the two of them that they were taking me along, because they weren't taking girls along because girls talk and they scare the fish away. So I was paying my way in with the two cheese Danish to bring for my mom, and they loved it. So I was allowed. I don't think too many girls were allowed, a few of other ones too. But you had to buy your way in to go for the... Without the cheese Danish, I don't think they would have let me. And I, white fish usually, some of them maybe this size, what would you say, about 7 inches, even those. And that's brought home, and mom prepared them in a sweet and sour sauce with raisins or something like this. So we had a lot to do, you see. All healthy things to do. You know something? Whatever we had to do, we were never bored. There was work around the house too that we had to help. We were never bored, and we didn't know about all the luxuries that the world had. So we weren't missing anything. Very happy childhoods from all of us, as far as I know.
How were the relations between the Jewish community and the non-Jewish community?
Yes, wonderful. There was absolutely never, I don't remember, at one time I remember without anti-Semitic remark or something, that something happened. I was the first Jewish girl that was given by the teacher. As I said, I was sort of the favorite for that late teacher. when I was in fourth grade. The first, second, and third, I was where the nun was teaching. But in the fourth grade, when I was, she gave me the privilege to be the school sales lady for the books and pencils that children needed, and helping her bring the books home. And what was the main thing I wanted to tell you? And I almost forgot. And oh, yes. And she decided that Jewish children usually spoke Jewish at home. And our older sister, Zosia, was living with us. Gertrude was already the first one that I said, the oldest one, alive. The first child died. And the two boys, the oldest one, emigrated to America in the same year that I was born. The picture in the book shows me about 8 or 9 months old. This was the farewell picture from her to the family. And she left, and she lived in New York City. And uncle, my mom's brother, sent the papers, the affidavits for her. And she went to America when she was 17. She's 16 years old, and I was almost a year old. So she went to the United States. So Zosia was at home, and Zosia decided when we came home from school, every time we spoke, the three of us together, Zosia, the oldest one, Zosia was 14 years older, and Gertrude 16 from me. And so when Danka and I came home from school, we were speaking Polish with her. So it ended up that we spoke pretty good Polish, and we did a lot of reading, which maybe other children did. So the teacher decided that I was good enough in the Polish language, and she said I was a pretty good talker, too. She said, I think that's why I got the speech. I got a speech for the national holiday, which was the President Marszałek Piłsudski. He was the liberator, fought for liberating Poland from the Russians, from Poland occupation, and a hero, Polish hero. And on the, because of the nation being 90% Catholic, they celebrated not his birthday when he was born, but his saint day. His name was Joseph, and on March 19, I think it's the St. Joseph Day, there was a big celebration at front of City Hall, all the dignitaries sitting on two benches on a veranda, and then the ones who had speeches and would come up and stand next to a table. I was so short that they had to put me in a little stool because the public. And then the public means everybody in town, because everybody had children in school, assembled outside, the Jewish families and other ones, listening to the speeches and to the songs. That teacher that I said, the late teacher, she played beautifully the violin. So the song, there was first speeches, and I had this the first, and I think the last Jewish girl that had a speech, and she, I think it was because of the language, that I mastered the Polish language better than the other ones. Or maybe she thought I was a good speaker, I don't know. That I got this speech, and nobody after me after I finished grade school. And then there was the singing. The children assembled the singing. But when it came to the singing, I have a terrible voice. She took me from the first row to the back, and she said, move your lips. So that's all I did. And I was never mad at her because she was so nice anyway and gave me so many other privileges. In fact, I had the privilege because in school there was one. Oh, yes, the reason I told you about the speech was because I wanted to tell you, one of the girls was jealous, a Gentile girl. That's the only time I experienced. Janka Migash was her name. And she stole the speech from me. I took it to school. So in recess, when the girls were everybody was going out, I practiced reading, and so I will know it by heart. Didn't have the speech in front of me. I had to learn it by heart, the teacher said. And she stole it from me, and the teacher made me another copy. And this was the only experience that I had otherwise within. And then was a boy, he was 3 years in the same grade or something. He wasn't very smart, but he was mean. And there was Moshe Goldfinger, and every time he picked on him, kind of a boy that is timid and soft-spoken, and he picked this one. That bully picked on this boy and pulled his pants. And the third and the fourth grade, I didn't do anything about it, but it bothered me terribly because Moshe was shaking, and I didn't stand the injustice of a bully. Then one day when I was in fifth grade, I waited there, but I knew he'd meet me during recess. And after he pulled his pants, I punched him in the nose. And then I went right back to school. I had to jump up for went to school. And he came in later, about 5 minutes later, with a bloody nose. And the teacher said, what happened to you? He says, Rena punched me in the nose. She turned away to the side. I could see. I was grinning first. She wanted to laugh so hard. She was grinning a little bit. She says, you must have deserved it if Rena did it. And I have a little bit of water. So this is about all the anti-Semitism that came in parents with the other neighbors, if we needed something, if we didn't have, we had a woman that was taking the cows out to pasture, and if we didn't have that woman that was sick, somebody else would take over. And really very nice life. Even when on September 1st, 1939, the Hitler's armies marched in, they were forbidden to make any deals with Jews. Borrowing a cup of sugar would have been a deal. And they didn't listen to it, and they risked their life, sort of, with still living nicely and being nice and kind. Some of them, almost most of them. There was one that didn't act so nicely, but it isn't even worth mentioning.
When you were in school, you mentioned that you had a lay teacher and a nun that was a teacher. What kinds of subjects did you learn in the public school?
Everything that this public school teaches. No religion in school. The children had on Wednesday afternoon, the Catholic children had on Wednesday afternoon religion, and the Jewish children could leave. Had the privilege to leave the school. And on Saturday, there were classes too, a heavy day, because Wednesday was a heavy day, and that's why Saturday they had a heavy day of school. And the Jewish children were free to stay home because of the Sabbath. We didn't write on the Sabbath, and we couldn't carry things on the Sabbath because there was a small town. There were no telephone wires around. It has to be closed in order to carry something, but even a handkerchief. The Hasidic, the Orthodox Jews, rules were there that you don't carry. If you wanted a handkerchief, you tied it around your wrist to wear it, and no carrying, no money, anything. So homework, the teacher was so nice, all the teachers, the nun too, that it was never given on Saturday. Always the homework for the weekend was given on Friday. So the Jewish children could do their homework on Sunday before we came to school. So it couldn't be any nicer. Just wonderful memories from it that they lived in peace. And during the war, as I said, they couldn't deal with Jews. But if they allowed us, if we were working, handwork, doing something for a Gentile, then we could get something for it, either money or food for it. And my older sister, Zosia, escaped during the war later on after the Germans came in and they forbid us all proclamations for the no going to, we couldn't go to a doctor. They took away all the privileges from us that free people have. Going to a doctor, seeing a dentist, we couldn't go from one town to the other one visiting somebody. We couldn't earn a living, and we couldn't, with the farmers, and the stores, I think, was still open, the kosher butcher was still open, but we couldn't have, later on they forbid that too, we couldn't have, go buy in for money in the store, but if you made something or did something for the Gentile, so my sister Zosia was escaped with a little boy, he needed tonsils removed, it was already scheduled to the doctor and they wouldn't allow it. So he had a guide like I had later and they brought her to Czechoslovakia and she had done the surgery done and she remained in Czechoslovakia. She had two children at that time.
Okay, I want to stay back before the war. I wanted to ask you, when you weren't in school, summers for example, did you have any jobs that you did or?
Not in grade school. Okay. After grade school. After grade school I went to extended education courses they were offering because there was no official high school there or gymnasium, it's called there. Then the local teachers arranged from all the schools, from the two schools, that there were some people didn't know how to read and write. So that was for the elderly who didn't know how to read and write. It was for the one who wanted to advance. Like I finished the seventh grade. My teacher kept me for one more year to the eighth, so I was a little bit 14, older than the other children. And then she kept me for helping correct the homework from the lower classes. So, and then she and the other teachers arranged that from other towns, from Greens, that teachers came in and taught during the whole year for extended education. And I had already studied the Germans. I didn't take the German there if they were offering it. And also the subjects, what you teach in extended education after grade school. But most of the children were just in grade school education.
Okay. Did you have any idea while you were in your town before the war of what was going on in Germany?
Oh, yes. We didn't have an intelligent newspaper, but in Krynica, as I said, 7 kilometers from us was a world-famous resort, it's Krynica. There were villas. There was all the luxury that anybody can imagine. You could hear on the corso while walking, you could hear 5-6 languages, foreign languages speaking. People from all over the world used to come to the mountains for the winter for skiing and the summer for mineral baths they had there. So they were there. So this was also part of the children when we were old enough after grade school to take a walk, the 7 kilometers to Krynica. We could go to Krynica and we could listen to famous singers. Jan Kepura was a Polish famous singer, Marta Eger. You probably don't know the name, but they were very little known here in America, even though he died and lived the last years of his life when the Germans came. They escaped to America, he and his wife. And Marta Eger and both singers. And so we would go to a famous singer like this one, Jan Kepura, and on the Deptak were benches there, and you had to pay something to go and listen to the concert. And he dedicated it every winter. That was in the fall, usually. Every winter he dedicated all the money to the poor people. So we were allowed to go to Krynica, for example. And we could, we didn't have a radio, and we didn't have a gramophone. So there wasn't much music. So this music, and while we went to Krynica, they played music there too, in one of the places where the mineral water was.
Can you spell that for me, Krynica?
Krynica, K-R-Y-N-I-C-A. You would pronounce it Krynica, but the C is pronounced in Polish as Krynica.
Thank you. This is tape 2. We're interviewing Rena Gelissen. It's January 24th, 1996. We were talking about life before the war and some of the jobs that you did before
the
war.
Did I tell you first that I shared the Hebrew lessons with my sister Danka when I came home from the Hebrew school? I shared this, so she knew all the lessons and she could read it and write it to the Hebrew. Not the German, I didn't share. The German have two alphabets. They have the Gothic alphabet and the regular. So it was a little bit difficult for me to bring it home and share it with her. And I was the 2-year older sister, and the other sister was 14 years old, already married and had her children. So I was the guardian of my younger sister. And pass up of the kleiner, watch out for the little one, was always. And I took it seriously later on. The rest of my life I took care of the little one whenever it was necessary. But during the year that I was going for extended education, in the summers we needed some pocket money. We were living from the farm mainly, and we had enough food and everything else. But there were some things that a young girl, wants to buy, and Dad said it's okay, so long as it is somewhere. You had to stay there if you want a nanny to a Jewish family's child, because they wanted you to stay in a room with the child if they had one child. And for my father, he had to check first if it was a kosher restaurant and a kosher hotel. If it was a kosher hotel, a restaurant, he approved of everything, then it was okay. And I had, for 2 summers, a little 4-year and then 5-year-old boy there. And they were from Lwów, I think. And for the whole summer, and they paid me, and I had the food there in the hotel and everything, a hotel room, and the baby was sleeping in the same room with me, so the parents could go out late at night, go out to concerts, whatever was available there for them, and dances. And I took care of the little boy. And then for 2 summers I did this, and then later on I found out. I was studying sewing when my sister Zosia was a dressmaker, by the way, when she still had, when I started about the war talking, but I should have told you before. When she was married, she was still doing some, a little bit dressmaking. But before she got married, she was the dressmaking business in our house. We extended one room extra for her. And then when she was married, she still was doing a little bit, and I learned to sew from her, from my sister. And Danka learned to sew from her a little bit too. So both of us knew a little bit how to sew. So I went to Krynica, and I went into a store that was selling Tiroler from Germany. In Tirol, they make embroidered things from unfelt, and you had to put them together. So it's so parts of a skirt with decorative straps or jackets with some under lapels, some decoration, embroidery, hand embroidery. So I went to the store and asked if I could have a job there, and yes, they hired me. And in that Jewish hotel again, because I was eating there too and sleeping there. So for several weeks during the summer, sometimes one summer I did the whole summer there. I worked the whole summer making, putting together those decorative outfits for little girls and for boys and for older people, some of the things too, like scarves they were making, and earned some extra money.
Let's go to the war itself. What were your first signs of danger that something was happening?
Well, something was happening reading in the paper what was going on since 32. Already bad things. It started 29, it started a lot earlier with Hitler. But when he came to power, I think it's 32 and I was reading. And at one point we had the Jewish families knew that the German Jewish families didn't have it. They had hardships already. So some of the families invited children from Germany to come for the vacation in the summer and to have a few weeks in Krynica. And while they were in Krynica, they wanted to see some surrounding things, and people could sign up that they wanted to take him. And we took him because we had a farm, and they could see the animals, and they could spend the whole day with us. So some of the children came, and they told us a little bit, like 10-year-old children, 11-year-old children, don't know very much, but they told us, and it was first-hand information. And then it got to us already really good, especially if children have to suffer. And there were some hardships and anti-Semitism and everything. So we knew a little bit about it, but not in the wildest dreams would we expect what happened after they came in. I was 19 years old on August 24, and they marched in on September 1st, 1939. Okay. And they were already in Czechoslovakia because the annexation, Czechoslovakia, so they were 4 kilometers from us already there. So when we escaped, that's why the hardships after they came was not so difficult, because it was a short distance only to the Czechoslovakian border. But that's how my sister escaped too, because it was so close with her little boy that she could escape Zosia.
Okay, but before you get into the escapes, yeah, let's talk about what happened when the Germans first came into your town.
The first day that they came in, they got themselves a list from the city of the Jewish families. They picked one man. They decided, by their decision, to call to as appoint as the Jewish elder. His name was Joseph. I don't want to use last names because I used his name in the book too. And Joseph was appointed. They summoned Joseph to come to come to their quarters and give him a complete list of all the young Jewish people, boys and girls. He was forced to do it, okay? It wasn't volunteer work, so, or else he would be shot, okay? Then the Jewish girls got from a notification after they had the names, they had to be, they're assigned to their quarters, and there was some of them scrubbing floors and some of them polishing boots or everything in one building if there weren't too many. And we had to go in the morning, go in there until they said, you can go home now. We're working there. No pay and no food or nothing at all. Just slave labor. We started out already there. So for the rest of it that came later, like Auschwitz, I had a little bit preparation knowing what they were doing. And then there were all kinds of hardships on the Jews. As I said before, they couldn't go to another city, and they couldn't buy, and they couldn't do any. All the freedoms were taken away. And then they decided, but they were still going to the temple and praying. One day they decided, and they were still wearing the beards and payas, what Hasidic Jews wear. One day they decided all the men have to come to the temple, assemble in the temple. And we had some rumors from Germany sometimes. I think it was that they burned the temple with the Jews in it or something. So we were terrified. So Father left for the temple, and we were living close to it, so I could sneak out from the house, and I could see from our street that they were carrying the books, and then at the end of it, the Torah scrolls, had to throw them on the ground and then light a match, and they had to have them on the Sabbath, they wanted them. They knew it isn't allowed to do it, and they knew they were the holy books. So their punishment on the Jews, they had to have satisfaction all over. There was no limit to it. Whatever they knew, it's going to hurt you more than they did. The first thing they started with the books on that one particular Sabbath, and burning the books, and then they told them to remove their hats, because Orthodox Jews always wear hats, either a kapala or a regular hat. They removed the hats, and they had some tucks there, whatever hood they assigned there to it, to shave their beards and the payas. Because the Jews, Orthodox Jews had the heads shaved anyway. They were, but they were wearing locks, I think you call them locks, the payas, and beards. And then they locked up the temple. They didn't burn the temple, locked up the temple after all the books were burning. And then they were making remarks to the Jews and putting him down and calling him names and everything while they were doing it too. After everything was burned, the father came home. And I have never seen my father before. Never seen it like this. He looked like the whole world was, it was ended for him. But we were happy that he came home. That was still alive, okay? So we weren't as stressed as he was. But I felt sorry and I felt terrible for him, and so did Mom and Danka. And then my sister, I read this before, but I should tell you now again, escaped to Czechoslovakia with a little boy to have the surgery that was necessary to remove his tonsils. And, excuse me. And then they forbid us, then came harvest time, which was in September, was very close to it. We had to come to work anyway, and we had planted potatoes and all the other grains, all planted. And the usual thing was that the Jewish people had some, like migrant workers here, some farmers, young people, were hiring themselves out to work for everybody, for Gentiles and for the Jewish farmers that they had, for money to pay them by day. And they were doing the harvest work, the hard work, because we were just the two of us there, two girls, and my father and mother were already older people. So we hired them. They were helping. They were with them there, and we were feeding them and paying them money. So Mom was cooking for them the whole day, and this was forbidden. So the harvest of cutting the grains and everything and treating it and making it into flour was out of the question. We couldn't do that. But we still had planted potatoes, and Danka and I usually helped with the potato diggings too. So sort of a necessity and sort of a fun, but we knew how to do it. So we would, after the work in the fall that we did for the Germans, the slave labor, we would go out and take a lantern with us, you know, and petrol, what do you call it? The lanterns with us, and with the lanterns as long as we could to the night, and then a couple of hours sleep, and then in the morning go again for slave work. So we dug out all the potatoes, and father would come with the wagon and with the yards and with the sacks, and we had the potatoes in a potato cellar. And then this is all we could have, so if we needed flour or something, we had to buy. So Duncan and I started sewing. She learned a little bit sewing from Sosha, and I did, because Sosha wasn't home anymore. When she was home, she was earning some money, and she was helping us. We were all one family, waiting together. One day, I remember, there was a really short on flour, and there was a little piece of bread like this on the table, and Mom gave it to me, and I gave it to Danka. Danka gave it back to Dad, and Dad gave it back to Mom. And it stayed on the table and dried up. None of us wanted to touch it. So we were pretty hungry if this was the case. Sorry.
It's okay.
And then they forbid the Jews to assemble for their prayers on Saturday. So they decided to do it anyway, some of them, not all of them. I don't remember. I don't think it was all of them. My uncle Beryl, my father's brother, lived in town too. And he lived out of a little bit out of town more, not in the center of town. So decided maybe in this house, a farmhouse too, they won't notice it. So they didn't dress up in the Becky shindig like Sabbath, just in a regular suit. And they went there for prayers. And it was forbidden to pray. Not only forbidden in the temple to pray, forbidden assembling. And this is called assembling. So one of the Sabbaths, later on, somebody betrayed them. I don't know, or maybe they found out by themselves. I don't want to accuse anybody. I don't know it for sure. But there's two German soldiers, two Nazis, are walking into the room, and there they are, all the men there that were assembled. And I said, didn't you know the proclamation? Didn't you read it? And don't you know that you are not supposed to assemble at all? They naturally didn't give an answer. And I'm going to tell you, he says, what is going to happen to you. Every time you're going to assemble, you have a choice. You want to assemble, that's okay. One of you is going to die. And today it's going to be you. And it was my father that they picked. After they left, and they were taking him to a place out of town, it's by the river, it's called the Fence by the River. And Fence was known that many of them, Jews from other towns, were killed there. And I think some Gentiles that did something against their politics and their whatever they wished were there, and they were shot to death. So the Jewish elder, Joseph, the minute they left, started running from my uncle's home all the way. He was out of breath when he came to our wood. The windows were open. It was a summer day. And I was standing by the mirror, not far from the window, combing my long hair. I had braids. And he said, Rena, run. He said, you know, I was told the social wasn't there. Run for your father. They just took your father to the river, to the fence by the river. And so I was combing my hair. I was wearing just a dirndl and bare feet, and I was supposed to wear a white band with the Star of David in blue embroidered on the arm. I forgot the Star of David. I forgot the shoes, and I let the hair just hang loose, and I started running. While I was running, it was a gravel road, and there were stones there, but I didn't feel the pain at all. I was just one thing in mind. I was going. And then when I came there, I said to myself, what do I do now? What did Joseph call me? What to do? What can I do? I'm going to fight with German soldiers. And then I said, oh, what am I going to say when I come home? And tell Mom, I just watched my father getting killed. So I jumped in front of him. I said, you want to kill my father? I said, I was naive. And I said, I'm a young girl, and maybe it's going to make some difference that I'm going to back. I said, if you're going to shoot my father, you're going to have to shoot him through me. And they started laughing and making fun of me, calling him Jewish names. Look at the Jews and some other derogatory names. And she thinks that we're going to be caring about her, and then they got their guns. And before that incident happened, I was doing sewing, as I said, and one time a German officer came over to the window, knocked on the door. They weren't allowed to come into the house, as far as we know, because they never went to any Jewish home. And knocked on the window, opened the window. He said, I've got a sheet here. Could you make me two pillowcases? Could you? Didn't order anything, would you? I said, oh, yes, sure, yes, sir, yes, sir. I took the sheets and I made the pillowcases. When I said, when are they going to be ready? I had some other work to do that I needed for a living to make. So I said, in a week, okay. Oh, yes, that's okay. He came a week later, picked up the pillowcases, and then he came another time for his friend to make two pillowcases. Both times he left me some money. The second time when he came, I don't know if I should tell you, he asked me, can we come into your house? I was scared to death. I didn't know what does it mean, the two of them, when there were the two of them. And I said, can I ask my mom and dad? I shouldn't even have said that. This was already dangerous with any average one of the SS there, officers. So I ran and I said, Mom and Dad, they want to come into the house. And I said, okay, so go into the parlor and just sit on a chair and we see what they want. So they came in when they came, and they weren't allowed to come in, and we could have been punished for it maybe too if they come into a Jewish home, but there was no choice. So they came in, and then when they came in, Mom and Dad was sitting there, and I was standing close to the door when I walked in, the lads were in the room, and he said, do you have a gramophone? You know what this is, it's the old-fashioned kind for playing recorder to play records. I said, no, we don't. Do you have a radio? No, we don't. He said, would you mind, Rena, dancing with me? Miss Rena, he said. He asked me what my name was. My parents said, they were sitting like this, and I looked at their faces, white as a sheet, just shaking, sitting like this. Would you dance with me? I said, not a very good dancer. Sure, I had no choice. So if my body is going to be whistling a tune, and he whistled the tune until he was tired of whistling, he danced with me. I think it was English Waltz or was the Blue Donau Waltz, was it? And he said, thank you, Miss Rena. That was wonderful. I said, well, thank you. So I just have to say something. And they didn't shake hands with anybody, no parents and no me. And then they said, thank you very much, and they left. And while I was standing there in front of with my father, this had to be told because I heard some voices. And I was terrified. The guns were already pointed at us, two guns, both officers. They didn't think it's enough one, but both of them, those soldiers, I mean. And there was some kind of officer. I don't know their ranks really good. And in that moment there, I wasn't looking for it, and I wasn't interested. All I wanted is to do something for my father if I could. And I said, oh, I am really losing my mind. I heard voices from a distance. And about 2 minutes later, I see two bikes, two high-ranking officers on bikes coming. I knew the high-ranking because they had some medals and things like this. And I recognized that was Hans Jochsch, what was the name, the Austrian. He was from Austria, he told me too. I'm from Vienna, Austria. I don't know if he wanted to impress me or something, but he told me that. And the other one, he didn't tell me. And both of them coming, Hans Jochsch and his buddy, are coming by bikes. They stopped the bike. They took one look there and saw me and my father. First they called my father a dirty Jew. And how much I knew about expressions like this, I didn't know much. So I turned around and said, my father isn't dirty. See, look at the nice white shirt he's wearing. My mom washed it and my mom ironed it, I said. He's not dirty. I didn't know what it meant at that time. And the officers get off the bike. He looked at me, didn't say anything. And he said, what are you doing here? Oh, we've got time to shoot these two Jews. Oh, he said, it's a nice warm day. So why don't you hop on the bikes in the back and we go for a beer? Well, why don't you do the honors first and kill him first? Oh, you can do it tomorrow or the day after. You're going to have plenty of chances to do it, to kill anybody that you want to. He said, hop on the bikes and we take off. And they took off. And Dad and I stood there for just a few seconds. I didn't dare turn around. But I turned around, I looked at his face. And I was heartbroken just looking at his face. And we started walking. Not a word was mentioned. And then sort of a few steps that we made farther, we suddenly collapsed. We had to sit down in the middle of the road because the knees wouldn't carry us. It was his and mine both. We just couldn't walk any farther. So we sat a little while. It wasn't a busy road. This is in a little town. And we sat a little while without a word. We stood up and we came home. We walked all the way as fast as we could after this and came home. And Mom was standing outside and waiting and shaking like this, and so was Danka. I think at that time Zosia was still home too. We were waiting. So saved the life for once. For one time, not for long though. And then those two officers. Later I heard rumors that Hans Jochsch, I didn't see him afterwards. We worked for them, and sometimes I worked in the office where he was there too. I was coming in. But when we worked in his office, that was in Mushinka, a little place close to the that bordered on Czechoslovakia. And we were 4 kilometers farther away, okay? And when I came to Mushinka there to work for him, we had a bag with us because we had to work the whole day, had a little piece of bread with us. When we were leaving for home, there was usually something in the bag, more bread, that I assume that Hans Jochsch is the one that put it in our bag, putting it in, and there was some other things, some goodies, I think, one time was a bar of chocolate or something. So we worked, he let us do all the work, but we got some, because he didn't want for the other ones to show that he was some privilege giving to one Jewish girl, or two Jewish girls, Danka and I. And we were dreaming of it, the assignment is going to be there, so we have something, but it wasn't always every day there. And then one day we came there, and another time, and he wasn't there. So I asked the Jewish boys that worked for them too, and one of them thought that he heard rumors that he was sent to the front, the Russian front at that time, that he was sent to the front, and probably for the thing that he did for saving a Jew and a Jewish girl's life. But we have no proof for that. But we assumed the whole Jewish community thought about that, that this was maybe the case.
Did you ever try to run away from the Nazis, from your town?
Yes, I tried.
Can you tell me?
Yeah, I tried later. But the boys were working on details of cutting wood, because we only had wood stoves in Tillich, chopping wood for them and cutting out boards for some shelves to make or something like that. We were doing the cleaning and the other work, but all the Jewish boys were working too. And one of the days I was going home from work, and the boys were still working, and the officer in charge asked Alex, one of the boys, Alex asked him, who is that? The girl with the long braids. I had really long braids, I could almost sit on it. He said, this is Rena Kornreich. Oh. And then a couple of days later, there's pounding on the door of his home, and there is an officer, as drunk as barely standing on his legs, and said, bring me to Rena. Your son, Alex has to bring me to the father. He says, I said, okay, I go wake him right away. Why don't you come in and make yourself comfortable? Gave him a chair. He could barely walk, sat on the chair, and he went to tell his son Alex. The floor was just on the first floor where they were living there, and said, you get dressed quickly and you run to the corners and you tell him that to hide Rena. That's all. Tell him a German officer is looking for her to hide. He's drunk and God knows what he's going to do to her. But he got dressed and went there, and the officer is sitting there, but because he was drunk, the father was trying to... He said, what is taking him so long? He said, he's a sleeper, a hard sleeper, and a very slowpoke to a dressing. He's dressing. He'd be here any minute. So he ran all the way. It wasn't very far. He made it. To the, warned my parents about it and came back quickly there. And in between him coming back, mother brought me to the attic, because we had a farmer's straw on the whole top floor there, brought me to the attic and hit me under the straw, the farthest away from the stairs. And lucky she did, because about 5 minutes later, they were pounding. Mom and Dad stayed in the night clothes. And when he pounded on the hour with the rifle, pounded on the door, came, the boys looked sleepy. And Danka was hidden under the blankets there in the room. And they came out and acting sleepy. What's going on? I want Rena. I said, well, she isn't home. She went to another village. You are lying, you dirty Jews. I see if that is true. And I don't know how he made it, because Mom said he was drunk. He made it up the stairs from the hallway, was a staircase to go to the attic, walked up to the attic, took off his rifle again, he was holding it, and poked in the straw, looked around first, and there were some cabinets for the winter with flour and sugar and other things, like we have for a farm there. And we had a little bit of it. We didn't have so much of it. But he looked at it thinking that I'm hiding in one of those things there. And then he went and took his rifle off and started poking in the straw. At one point, he came about 4 inches from my head. And I was lying face down, Mom said, so he wouldn't hear the breathing, just in case he comes home. And then he finally gave up. After this, he went down. And it's a miracle Mom didn't faint when she saw him. Mom had to go with him, okay? And to show him the hiding place. She said, there is no hiding place. She's not here. He would have shot me probably in here at the same time and probably wanted to rape me. I don't know. They was not allowed. They weren't allowed to have anything in contact with Jews because there was Rassenschande. They were killing the Jews because to purify the race, their race. There were no Jews because the Jewish race wasn't worthy. So they luckily in our hometown didn't do any of those things, but this night he did. So the next morning my parents decided that the best thing is, so long as Zosia is in Czechoslovakia, to get me to Czechoslovakia. My father had a brother there and my mother. So. And they knew that in the meantime, there was a boy in town that sort of liked me. The whole incident of liking was maybe we exchanged words maybe 10 times in the whole growing up. When we were little girls, Danka and I, we were living next door to her. Our friends, best friends were living next door. And one day we came out and he was standing there, very handsome looking young boy, but a gentle boy, okay? And he said, can I bring you home? I said, no, we don't need it. The hill is very slippery because this was on the marketplace, and our house was all the way downhill. and it's slippery, and you might hurt yourself. I said, okay. So he took Danka one hand to me, one hand, and walked us home. And he did that during that winter, maybe two or three times. And then the next year, he wasn't there because he went to gymnasium to Krynica there. So I didn't see him. I didn't talk much about him. And then about when I was, I think, 15 or 16, one evening I was going for my friend. Danka wasn't with me that evening. And he said, can I join you? I said, well, it isn't slippery. It isn't winter. It wasn't in the winter. He said, I was sort of joking about it. And you know I'm not allowed to talk to you. Because one time, one of the elders of the Jewish community saw me in the town. And it was just getting a little bit darker. It was still light. But he had a lantern with him to go to the temple for, I think, Borchanovsky, Ladevitska, I forgot the real name for it. And came to the temple, told everybody that Rena is standing with a Gentile in the middle of the marketplace talking to him. Okay, so father and mother were absolutely upset.
Hold on, we might just want to wait for this plane, if we can do that.
Yes, I'll just go ahead, just like this, because I'm rolling.
This is tape three. We are interviewing Rena Gelissen. It's January 24th, 1996. You were telling us about a Polish young boy.
Yes. The reason I'm bringing him in, because he has played a part, a very important part in my life. So when he was 18 years old, and I was... 18, and I was 15, he brought me down one day and said, can I go with you down the hill? I said, it isn't winter, it isn't slippery. And I said, you know I'm going to get in troubles with my father, doesn't allow that. And when I came down, we came by those old-fashioned water things, what do you call them, that you put on the water. I said, I have to say goodbye to, because that's too close to home. It's already my house. It's the next one after this one. And I don't want my father and mother to say and be grieved about it, I said. Because this was actually the worst thing about it. They were grieved about it. And so he placed a kiss on my lips very quickly, and he ran away. And then he told me, before the kiss, he told me, I signed up for the military. I'm going into Krakow. I'm going to be in Krakow. Can I write to you? I said, no, to my house you can't. I said, no way, my father see correspondence with you. Oh, they would die and would kill me, I said. And he said, suppose I write it to my mother and my two sisters. He didn't have a father. Father died in World War I. And he said, I write it to my sisters, and my mother and my sisters love you, and they're going to bring you the letters on the marketplace anyway. And I said, okay, if you think this way, but I don't know if I can answer you. Oh, yes, you can. You don't have to. You give mom the letters, and she's going to mail them for me. And that's what we did after this email. But anyway, this is the boy that went away and then sent me money to come to Krakow when he had already the stripes and he was an officer. This is years later. I was at that time 18, and that's a year before the war, and he was 21. And he said he would want me to come then and marry me. We did correspond, and it wasn't so much about love talking, how are you doing, how are your parents, and things like this. And love you at the end, and I wrote down love you too, but I didn't know it was that serious. And I said, once he asked me before, I said, not in a million years. This would kill my parents, I said. I couldn't do that. And then he asked me again, I want you to know, he said, in the holder, he said, that you can buy you a silver candelabra, and you're going to light the candles just like your mama does. He says, and you can bring up the children in the Jewish faith, And if this doesn't work, he said, I'm sending you the money to come to Krakow because I'm entitled to an apartment and we could get married now. And the children you can bring up, he said, and you can do everything as you did at home. And if worse comes to worse, they don't want to have myself circumcised and accept the Jewish religion. So I received the letters, previous ones from the mother or the sisters, and this one too. I didn't even tell a word about it to my parents, just telling him about it and about the correspondence. We'd already heard him terribly. I didn't do anything. So I just sent the money back and I said, I'm very sorry if I lead you on or something, and I can't marry you, never. I can't do that to my family, not in a million years. So this was the end of it. And then comes the war. He was a pilot. And he was fighting. He was escaped to Russia, escaped from Russia back home. When he came home, he was doing underground work, bringing officers, considering the borders are closed. This was the best connection between Czechoslovakia from Poland for Polish officers to escape from Poland to Czechoslovakia, and they had another organization the same there, and then to Hungary, from Hungary, I think, to Italy, and then to England, and they formed an army in England. And so he was bringing over the officers because he knew the borders so well, just only before he used to ski, and so he knew the whole territory well. And everybody in town that wasn't German or SS knew that he was doing that work, or many people did. So my father knew too, and when that officer came, and when that night, the next morning, my father said, you're going to go to Czechoslovakia. You have to go, you have to escape, because he can come back tomorrow again. And I don't want to live, Mom says, to watch something like this. He was drunk, and he can do just about anything. He should us all, too. I said, well, there is no choice. And my father said, I'm going to... No, he didn't say anything. He just asked one of the neighboring boys, the Jewish boy, send over to... He was home in civilian clothes. The military, the Germans, Angie was home. They didn't know anything about him doing that work, naturally. And sent over the little boy, said, would you go over and ask Angie Garbera to come to the Kornreich's home? And the same morning he came to the Kornreich's home, Angie walked in, didn't say anything to me. Father shook his hand for the first time in his life. And my father must have loved me a lot. To, after not talking to a gentle boy, to ask him, would you please bring my daughter? I know you're doing that kind of work. And I know she'd be safe with you. Would you bring her to Czechoslovakia tonight? He said, sure I will. I haven't got no money to pay you, he said, because sometimes he got paid if they had money. If they didn't, he brought them without money. He said, Mr. Conner, we had friends since childhood. Since we were little children, we played when we were little children. Then teenagers, we didn't. And then now is the time he's a grown-up. And he said, now if we were childhood friends, and I wouldn't take it if you had the money, Mr. Conrad. And father offered him a cigarette for the very few that he still had. They sat down, they had a cigarette. I wasn't consulted, wasn't told anything about it, nothing. This is the Hasidic family, so they make arrangements. But father knew that I won't object, because if it's my life saving, and it's definitely with him, I wouldn't object. And he said, Mr. Kornreich, he shook his hand when he left. I give you my word of honor of an officer that as far as I can help it, and not a hair is going to fall off her head, he said, and I'm not going to touch her more than holding her hand because the territory is rough. Am I allowed to do that? Yes, father said. And this was the last time that I talked to him. The last time I talked to him when he brought it to Czechoslovakia. Not the last time. He came another couple of times afterwards. He came one time with a package. He brought me to a farmer that was working for the underground, and the farmer was friendly with German officers and played cards with them at night to cover up for a cover-up, just pretend. So the officers had no idea that he was working for the underground. And the morning the farmer, I got dressed in farmer's clothes and brought to my uncle, and the next day Andrzej came to bring me clothes for my mother, because I was only in the jacket I had and a pair of boots I was wearing for the muddy road, and nothing else with me. So he brought some clothes and I think a big package about it. He risked his life again and to bring it all the way to Czechoslovakia, to the city. And then he came one more time to tell me that he... One more time he came to tell me, can I talk to you? He said, he came to the door with something from home. Can I talk to you? I said, I don't want my uncle and my aunt to see we are talking. I said, this is embarrassing. You know how they are, they're all Hasidic Jews. And they have objection to it. I'm sorry, I said, but I can't. He said, I've got something very important to tell you. I said, okay, let's go here a little bit to the side. My aunt can see it. And he says, my brother lives in Czechoslovakia. I knew his brother is married with a Slovakian girl, lives only 15 kilometers from there, which is 15 kilometers, like 10 miles, something. And they have a nice big house, and they already dedicated a big room, a separate room. I heard rumors they're going to take Jews to camps, to war camps. But if if they're mixed marriages, they're not going to take. My brother left, gave me that room, and gave me the opportunity to have a little stove there and everything cooking. Can I marry you? If I marry you, I can save your life, he said. I said, I still can't do it. But your parents, you don't even know if your parents are going to be tomorrow alive. They are there in Poland, and you know what they're doing there. Don't you want to save your life? I said, not at the price of what they're going to pay for it. I said, I'm sorry, I can't do it. So he left, and about one other time I saw him in Czechoslovakia, and I didn't talk to him because I had a Jewish boy that I met, and I was going with the Jewish boy. My uncle arranged it, and my father was, and mother were happy about it, so I did it. But I told that boy that I had somebody that I really liked a lot, or loved. By that time I was grown up enough to tell him, yes, I did love him too. And I didn't acknowledge even his presence there when he passed by in the street, which I'm sorry to this day that I didn't, because he saved my life and I didn't even say that. I didn't know what that Jewish boy is going to feel like. It. So he said, but my face was red. So he said, who is that boy? Is that the one? I told him I can't marry you, the Jewish boy, because I love somebody else. And he said, was that the boy? I said, yes. Why didn't you go over to him and say thank you or say hello to him? I said, well, I didn't know how you're going to take it. He said, like a normal human being, he said, like somebody grateful that he saved your life. I said, so I looked around and the street was empty. And about a couple of months later, he was dead on one of those trips. He was hiding on a tree and he froze and had pneumonia and he died. So that's the last time on the street that I saw him. It was Andrzej. And then I came home after this. A couple of months later, I came home because I heard rumors they're going to displace all the Jews away from Tillich because Tillich and Mushinka are too close to the Slovakian border. And apparently some Jews escaped or something, and they probably noticed me too disappearing there in Zosia. And they don't trust the Jews anymore. And you can go anywhere you want to. Excuse me. ...25 kilometers away from the border. You can take what you... We remember we dug out potatoes and there was a full cellar of potatoes still. It's in the winter. It's in the fall, the next year, but there was still some potatoes there. and you can... When I came home, I had a guide, another guide hired, my uncle hired, then I came home. Because the parents were elderly, and I thought I can do a lot more for them, and I can sew to earn some money, too, for a living. And then you can take one loaf of bread, and you can take one change of clothes, you can take 500 zlotys. Well, the zlotys wasn't a problem because we didn't have 500 zlotys. We had a little bit less than that. But the change of clothes and things like this, so I sneaked in the sewing machine under the clothes and under the straw that we take with the horse and buggy. The cows, everything else, the potatoes in the cellar, everything that we possessed, all the clothes in the wardrobes, everything, jewelry or whatever, had nothing we could take with us, and to leave the key in the door. So we left. I went back one day I went back on foot. This was like 30 kilometers. I went back by foot back to ask the sheriff from the town to risk my life because the Germans were there. I wasn't supposed to be there. To ask the sheriff I wore a babushka with a long braid so and the clothes like they're wearing more, not what I was wearing. And ask him if he let me take one cow because the farmer we were living, we gave him all the money we had and then we had nothing else to buy food or anything. So at least we have some milk that I can have a cow. He gave me permission and gave me a signed paper that I'm allowed to take the cow because there were Germans going on trucks and back and forth. And one of them passing me by said, they did see, I was wearing the band then with the Star of David, and they said, Auf Wiedersehen in Jerusalem. So meaning we're going to conquer the whole world in Jerusalem too. My heart was going like this. We'll see you in Jerusalem, he said. So it means they're going to conquer the world. So I just drudged down further. I stopped in one Jewish home on the, in the halfway on the way home with this one after this, and they let me keep the cow there overnight, and they gave me some food, and I could sleep there. Then I brought the cow to that farmer, and which one would you like to finish this story? With the farmer there, and I started sewing on that sewing machine that I took with me. And there were some guides that brought over, Tolek is his name, a Gentile guide from Mushenka. And Tolek brought Danka over to Czechoslovakia. And with Esther, the little girl from my sister. Sister Zosia had two children, the little boy that needed surgery. And Esther was 6 years old. She was still, or seven by that time. She was still at home with my grandparents and with us. And then Danka, when Danka brought her over, brought her over after me, Branka brought her over, and she stayed a while in Czechoslovakia. But both of us came back. The little girl stayed with her mother. We sent her to Bratislava. She stayed with Zosia. Zosia had two children with her, and she was working for a Jewish family, a widower and a son as a housekeeper there, and she could keep the children there. And we stayed with the parents and moved to that town, and I started sewing and earning some money. But the guides who brought her over, none of them charged a penny. So they didn't know us at all. So you see, we were living with the Gentiles, something that I want to emphasize because they deserve it. You have to acknowledge it. At least I think so. My conscience tells me so. And two different ones, so three different guides between Danka and the little girl bringing over, between bringing her back and bringing me back. There were three different boys, and they didn't take any money for it. In fact, one of them, Tolek, came over someday, and he asked what we're living from. And I said, well, I earn some money. I try to earn some money here with sewing, but it's very little. So one day he came over with a box full of almonds. He said, I got these from Czechoslovakia. I bought. They were very cheap. I could get a lot of them. That's what he was telling me to make me feel good. And you go to Grebov, to father to the Jewish families, and you can sell them. So several times he brought over almonds.
I have two quick questions. Can you give me a time frame? When is all this happening, going back and forth from Czechoslovakia?
Okay, we were I was the first time in Czechoslovakia. Let's see, we moved in September, October, November, December. December I went to Czechoslovakia. In the spring I came back because of the rumors, okay? In the spring of 1940. In the fall of 1940, we are sent away, we are displaced from our home, we're sent away. And we are in the fall of 1940, I'm sewing to the part that I just came and trying to earn, and he brought the almonds, and I sold some almonds were there. And suddenly there were rumors that in the fall of 1940, rumors that they took some Jewish girls somewhere in another town to the military compound and used them as prostitutes there. Well, Mom got up one morning, Mom heard it, or there was some clandestine Jewish newspaper or something that she read it somehow. She said, this is what's going on, and you two are going to Czechoslovakia again. I hired Tolek. I said, Mom, I'm not leaving. I'm sewing, and I sell almonds or something, and we can live now, and I can work for it, and I can milk the cow in the morning. Because sometimes the farmer milked the cow before I came down to milk it. So I got up at 3 o'clock in the morning to try to milk the cow so we had some milk too. That farmer was really mean. That was in another town. I told you, 28 kilometers, really mean. And took all the money from us, and then he wanted the milk from the cow too. But anyway, this one hated the Jews, not the anti-Semitic, but hated the Jews. So I said, Mom, you can't, you're two elderly people. Let's be honest, Mama. I heard them. Whispered the night after this, when I told her, I heard them whisper the whole night, and we're going back and forth. And Mom said, no. My dad said, but what are we going to do? I don't care. So we're getting up in the morning. I heard the whole night they were talking about it. I got up in the morning, and Mom said, make yourself ready. Tolek is coming. You're going to Czechoslovakia, both of you. I said, Mom, I can't do that. And she said, okay. Would you rather have to die, go away, you never see me again? And I just die somewhere. I don't care if it's in the street or in the woods or whatever. I don't want to live to see my daughters raped, she said. Well, I had no choice. So the sled came in about a half an hour later, and we packed up a little bundle with a few clothes, and that's the last time we saw our parents. Riding away with the sled. sorry. They were running after the sled until there were specks of them just visit. We were on the knees on the seat. Danka and I were waving to them, and they were waving to us. And that was the last time I saw him. This is now winter 1940, and it's December, the end of December. Excuse me. And Tolle came, brought us over. There were some four, five more Jewish people from the town, from village, that were living in Florinka. The place is called Florinka. You need spelling of it?
Please.
Yeah. F-L-O-R-Y-K-A. Florinka. And so we left Florinka. And then after we came over the border, soon my sister made arrangements with Jewish families to-do Jewish families in Bratislava. That's where she was. So we didn't go to the uncle anymore, but we went to Bratislava where the sister was because we wanted to be together. It was always a very close-knit family. We loved each other, and we had wonderful parents. I don't know how many times I mentioned it, but you know, by the father just letting me go to Czechoslovakia like this must have loved us a lot, and they really did. And so we went to Bratislava. I was staying with one family, Danka with another family that had a little boy, so she was more nanny to the little boy. And with this family, there was well-to-do family. They had a housekeeper, and they had a cook, and they had a cleaning woman. I was the spicer assistant. I had the keys, and I went with the woman to do shopping, and I watched the things that she was taking out there for the cooking and helping a little bit with the cooking there in Czechoslovakia. And then there were rumors again they're going to take Jewish people, and especially young girls they're going to start taking. And the family Stahler was the name from the family that I was with, the Jewish family. They said, it would be better that you be in a small place, and we got contacted some family. I forgot to tell you, that spring, there when we were there, this is already almost 6 months later, but I'm telling you now. But before that, it was Passover, and I tried to call the first Passover when I was at my uncle's. I sent over raisins that father could make the wine at home for Passover, and I sent over matzahs in a package, and they received it, okay? But this is the second Passover I'm there. And I knew a Jewish tailor that was sewing forcefully for the officers' leather coats. And I knew him, and I said, I would like to call. How do you go about it, calling my parents and seeing if they're still there so I can send the package? He said, well, I'm going to bribe one of the officers and tell him I give him two coats so that other officers don't know about it, or a coat for his wife or something. Excuse me. And I make sure that he brings you telephone booths. He brought me the telephone booths. He called Florinka, got the post office, because in all those villages there was a telephone in the post office. And that was it. Nobody had telephones. Called Florinka, the post office. When he got connected, he said, this is a German officer. I'd like to speak to the chief of to the head of the post office. The head said, this is the head. And then he said, here. You're talking to the head. I'm going to give you a person now, and I want you to give it an honest answer, he said to him. And I said, I'm Rena Kornreich, and I, in Florinka, this and this house, I remember the name of the farmer, are living my parents, and I would like to speak to one of them. Could you send somebody? I can wait on the telephone, even though it's expensive. He said, you can wait. And send a messenger to get him. We waited about 5 minutes or 10 minutes, and the man on the other side of the telephone in Poland says, the messenger came back and said, in this house is only such and such family, the owners of it, and there is no Jewish family there, and they don't know anything about it. But this was the last time, so I didn't, and this time I didn't get contact with him. And I found out later after the war from Alex, because all the people that left village were sort of in the same towns on the earth, that they were taken all, probably before Passover, taken to a ghetto in Novosanj somewhere, or Grybów. He doesn't know for sure either, because he escaped to Czechoslovakia too.
But you were never in a ghetto.
Pardon me?
Were you ever in a ghetto? Okay.
I was not. Okay. He was with his parents. He escaped first to Czechoslovakia, then he came back, and when he came back with the parents, then he escaped from the ghetto. Alex escaped. The same Alex that came as a messenger Excuse me. Is that allowed? That came to tell me that the SS officer is going to come. And he told me that they were all in a ghetto, and either they, assuming only things, rumors again, they died, they had the gassing vans, and they took the Jews from the ghettos if they wanted to get rid of them quickly, and they put them in vans and gassed them in the vans. And they had another group digging a hole, so they threw them in to somewhere in the hole. Or they took them to Auschwitz, and they died there in the gas chambers. I will never know. But the last time they saw him was on that sled, waving to them. And I can still see the picture, even the tiny little speck that we still looked at. And I can't tell it without crying, I'm sorry.
How long were you in Czechoslovakia now, this second time that you were there?
Okay, I'm now at the family in Bratislava. And you know, you want me to spell Bratislava? No?
Okay.
And in Bratislava, and they heard rumors that they're going to take the young girls, that it would be better. They contacted somebody, some Jewish committee probably, in a little town, Humene.
Could you spell Humene?
Humene.
That's a small town.
I think I can, yeah. Humene. Humene. As far as I remember. I've seen it spelled with one N one time in that book that I am. But I think this is the correct name. It's very close anyway. If you say how many people know where it was. So they contacted their people, and I didn't know in this same town were three girls from my hometown, Erna and Fela, that I met later in Auschwitz, and Dina. Erna and Fela Drenger and Dina Goldberger were in that same town. So I had some friends there when I came. And I was assigned already from Bratislava to go to a Jewish family, and the name was Silber. Silber, I think, is spelled like the German. S-I-B-E-R, I think, Silber.
S-I-L?
S-I-L-B-E-R, Silber. Yeah. And they had a five-year-old little girl, Gretchen, and I stayed there, and I helped a little bit in the house, so it was a young couple. The five-year-old the girl, and I stayed there with them for, this is in the fall of 41 until the spring of 42, almost a year, but not a year. And then big proclamations on every building and every office building, everything, from the Germans again. Any foreigner that is here in town, the people who have a foreignness, it's martial law from this moment on that you read that sign, and the whole family, whoever is hiding the foreignness, is going to be shot to death, and including the person that's hiding. So you have a chance to give yourself up. We're going to be such and such at the military compound and such at the hours to come and report to us, and you can then going to go to a military camp and work for a while, and then you can go back. That's what the sign said. So I had a choice at that time to be shot to death, myself, and the young couple, and the little girl. Now, they were mad at me I tell you later when they were mad at me, but anyway. And so I gave myself up and went to the military camp. I wrote a letter to my sister, and wrote a letter to Shani Gottlob. That was my boyfriend that I was supposed to marry in 2 weeks. The wedding was scheduled, and the people that I lived with gave me the money to buy the material, and Taylor made a rope for me and made some nightgowns. Everything was preparations to have it before the holidays. Yes, I think before the holidays to get married. And Danka said Danka was going to come, and Zosia couldn't with the children, but Danka was going to come to the wedding. And I wrote a letter to him, I wrote a letter to Danka, and went to the military compound, and I went in the afternoon, dressed, prepared to it without a coat, just a suit I was wearing, and prepared to come back after you stay right here, they said. And you stay right here was until the next morning, outside, with many other people there. I didn't have any conversations with them because I was freezing. I was holding myself, and I went on my knees, put down, and I pulled my pleated skirt. I had a pleated skirt and a jacket blazer, and I kept it over my legs. I was cold, and I was falling off, dozing off a little bit, and I was thinking already, what did I do that I came here? Was it the right thing to do? And then I kept thinking a bit again, there's a little girl there, and there's a couple. And the couple, there's a choice between the little girl, all the people get shot and myself too, or go to a work camp. So I decided to go to the work camp. Do I continue?
We can take a break.
Yeah. Oh.
This is take four. It's January 24th, 1996, and we're interviewing Rena Gelissen. You were telling us about, you turned yourself in for labor.
Labor camp, to save the lives of the people that were keeping me there for almost a year. And my life, too, at the same time. So this is the next morning where we finish. They brought me to pack my suitcase, told me to take warm clothes, because it's winter, and I thought I'd take the nice and warm clothes. I left there, I came to the train station, and at the train station I saw many Jews there, and didn't see a regular train, just cattle cars. You know what they look like. It's big, just a little square on the top, no doors or anything to it. And they put a something to lead the animals up. That was not for us. We were helping each other to go in and to... And by the time we ended up, when they closed the cattle cars, the doors, there were at least 80 or 90 of us there. There was no toilet facilities, only a bucket was there. And nobody could sit down on the suitcase even. That's how packed we were, really tightly packed. And there was one woman there with a baby in her arms, but that's not so important, I think, to talk about that. And nobody knew where we were going. And the one bucket, it took quite a while to anybody there to go to the bucket. I remember a daughter and a mother. The daughter was keeping the coat open so the mother could go on the bucket. But later on, we didn't pay much attention because the excrement was flowing over the floor. And this took, I was in a trance in this one. I wasn't thinking anymore. I was just thought, this doesn't look like we are going to a work camp. Not with someone, not a woman with a little baby. What is she going to do there? So I just... didn't pay attention, didn't even think. And suddenly I hear somebody here from Poland. And I listened for a while. I said, yeah, I am Polish, because they're all Slovakian Jews. I am Polish. And we would like to see the signs when we're going by. We saw from the side some signs. Okay, but if we get it straight after we passed by, they couldn't read it. I said, if it lifts you up, could you read the signs? I said, I will try. So two men lifted me up to that little square that is in that cattle car. And just iron bars, and it's open. That's all the air we were getting into that little square for animals. And I read Oświęcim. I said, yeah, that's a Polish name. The way Auschwitz in Polish is Oświęcim. And I spelled it to them. I said, this is Oświęcim. And this was all of it. And then just riding there and being miserable the whole time, not even thinking. And coming there, so many days later, I'm not sure it was 4 days or 5 days or I think between four and six days, something like this, because they were stopping. It isn't so far by distance, but they were stopping to pick up more Jews. And then we came in at one morning, 11 o'clock, I think it was a Sunday. I think it was we found out that it was the 26th. The 22nd I gave myself up, so apparently it was 4 days. And they told us to, prisoners in striped uniforms, men, came a Polish man that was talking German to us, but I found out later that they were Polish. Just jump off in German. They said they train quickly because they're going to beat you if you don't, and they're going to beat us too. So we don't want to beat you. We're supposed to beat you if you don't go fast enough. So you pick the suitcase up. It's 4 to 5 feet to the train. You are standing up all the time because there's no place to sit down or to lie down. You have to jump down. So it's a miracle that you didn't break both your legs. But with the suitcase, and then a pile of suitcases was ready before me because I was in one of the last compartments, and they got one of the last cattle cars. So there was a pile of suitcases, I assume. They were already out, and I was standing and lining up, and I saw the confusion, people going here, and children there, and grown up there, and the suitcase is there, just in a pile. So I'm an eight person, so I walk up to one, told me to go there, so I'm going there, but before I lined up with the younger woman, where they assigned me to, told me to go there, I walked closer a little bit to an assessment. I said, how are we going to recognize our suitcases afterwards, I said, if it's on a pile. He said, shut up and get in line. So we went in line and we started marching. This is the first Jewish transport. What we saw when we came in, only 1,000 of it were picked. The rest of them were somewhere. I was hoping the elderly people and children, the younger one and mothers with the baby, were going to this. I remember her officer asking her, I think the baby was dead. But he was asking, want to give up the baby? And she said, no. So she went with the elderly people. I said, hopefully they're going to go somewhere to a warmer place with their parents and with their grandparents. But the young girls, 1,000 of us are picked. I'm one of the 1,000. And we marched into camp, and I looked at the gate up, and on the top of the gate it said, Arbeit macht frei. And because I studied German, I knew what it meant, which work will make you free. We marched in, and through the big gate on the left side are the buildings, brick buildings. And on the right side, brick buildings, in the middle is a wall. It's a camp road, but it's divided with a wall. It looked like temporary because half of it was going to the camp, to the men's camp, and half of it on our side, because their entrance was on the other side, and ours was this entrance. We entered to a block, the buildings are called blocks. And this is block four. Going into block four, we're standing in line. I'm still standing in line, all of us. In five, we're standing to go in. So the first one's already going. And the building, to the back door from the building, coming out this door, in the front from the building, okay? And suddenly we see there people coming out with bare heads, and they look. I said already on the road, these men working without caps, and they were shaved their heads. I said, it looks like more. It must be an insane institution or something. Then I said, but they took us to work here. And what are those insane people doing with us? I still in my suit and still fairly decent looking and with expectations to be treated like a human being. And suddenly one of sisters was shouting to the other one, it's me, it's me. And then we found out that creature there with the shaved head and with the Russian uniform with the holes in it, with lice and holes from Russian, I know the things already because later I got the same uniform. And those are our sisters and our people. So by the time I came, they took away everything from us, my watch and everything. If you have something, it was raining and snowing, by the way. It's March weather. And they took away everything to the Jew. If you have any Jew, don't give it to them. You have no idea what they did to us. And I don't even want to tell you, the sister said. So throw away everything. I had a chrome watch, not a very expensive one that I had once. So I took the watch off and stepped on it. And otherwise, I had no jewelry. And we were poor farmers. So I walked in, and they said, ask me, where are you from, what nationality? I said, Polish. And that all of them was Slovakian. So she put me down that I was a Gentile, Polish. But I tell you why later that I'm telling you. So she said, but the discipline of processing is the same thing as with all the others. She said, take off this and take off this. But I said, how are we going to find out where to find the clothes? Throw it down there and share up. And they started, and then suddenly I hear shouting, hey, you with the earrings. I had from my grandfather, gave all his granddaughters on the first day of school a gold earring with a turquoise stone. So take those earrings off. And I was so used to it, wearing just those one earrings. It was part of me. So I took them, take off those earrings or I'm going to tear out of you. So I took off quickly the earring and put it in that box where the jewelry was. And then we started being processed, shaved the heads and all bodily hair shaved. And after they shaved us, they dumped us. We had to go in a flat with disinfectant there, which was burning like fire. And then we naked, we're standing in line. In the meantime, by the time it was my turn, other ones are coming out already with the Russian uniforms. Already they were processed. They're going this way to go outside. And we are going towards a table. From a distance, I noticed there is a table. And I heard the girls there. They had to lie down naked there on the table. And the officer with rubber gloves, the German officer, was doing something to them. And she was screaming. I had no idea for gynecological testing or something. They're looking for jewelry there. I didn't know what to do. But she was screaming, and another one was screaming. I said, I have to see to it that I don't make that table. So here is that other line. So I cheated them out of this one, too. That other line going already in to the clothes, yeah, from the table, process going to get the clothes, pardon me. And I slipped in there in the other room, and I didn't get to the table. So later on, I found out that they were looking for jewelry, if they were hiding this, in every crevice in the body. But anyway, I went without it. I went there, but I had the uniform. While we were picking the uniforms, we had to exchange with each other long pants. Some of them had no buttons, the Russian uniforms, hard buttons, big holes from the bullets in it. I didn't know where the bullets, and I didn't know from Russian uniforms. By the way, I'm saying Russian uniforms. I didn't know by that time because there were no insignia on it. I didn't know that they were. I found out later that they were Russian uniforms. Because in 1941, Germany attacked Russia, and this is, they took prisoners of war, okay? And we had those uniforms, and it, no underwear, nothing at all, just the uniforms with the holes and with the lice in it, because they were already for months there, for a whole year, I think, and a piece of wood, for different sizes of wood with a leather strip, and that was all the clothes that we got. And with that clothes we went, after we were processed, everybody was ready, they put like 80 of us in one room, or maybe more, we were quite a lot of them, and that was block 5, the next building to it. And when we walked in, there was a lot of straw lying on the floor, and nothing else in that room. And some of the girls sat down in those Russian uniforms, and suddenly, bed bugs were jumping all over us. They covered us, and we started screaming and crying. And I was one of the first ones to jump up and pound on the door, because anybody in your right mind would expect something like this. Human beings would do that to you. And I pounded, let us out, open up. The door was locked, by the way, and we couldn't go anywhere. And so the rest of the night, they were crying and screaming and sleeping. Some of them who could very exhausted sleep. I sat up, I slept part of the time, sat up part of the time, and I was praying and hoping for one thing only, that my sister Danka would not come, because I knew that I was a lot stronger than she, and whatever is going to happen after this, a pretty good idea that it's not a war camp or whatever it's going to be, but nothing decent and nothing humane treatment. And the next morning, we went to the, they got us out from that block and brought us over to the men's camp and put the tattoo on us. And my tattoo is 1,716. The 1,000 counts for the 1,000 German women they had there. From the Jewish woman, I'm the 716th there. So this is the first Jewish transport that ever came to Auschwitz. And the first woman transport, because they didn't have any women before. They had Poles and they had other people there, but not women.
What kind of work did they have you do?
First a couple of days they were waiting for more transports to come. So 3 days we weren't working, and the next day after the tattoo they put us in. They put my group of people with me in block 10. Block is the buildings again. It was 10 buildings, and there was a little fence, a wire fence, and then in the back of this was block 11, and then the other blocks, 14 of them were for the men on the other side. So after we were processed, we had the tattoo. We went to the block. To block 10, and when every morning after roll call, every morning we had to go on the street, on the camp road for roll call, I looked for the new transports coming in. And the second or third day, there was my sister, Danka. So my nightmare came true that I knew she's going to come, and I took her. She was supposed to go in other buildings in. But I took her by the hand and I said, don't say anything and pretend that you are just, she was wearing already the same uniform I was wearing. And I came to the block elder, it was already assigned, it was a Jewish girl from Czechoslovakia. And I said, could I have my sister with me here in this block? She said, okay. Somebody else was sleeping with me, there were 3 layers of bunk beds. And I asked the other girl to go to the, or somewhere else, could I keep my sister with me? So I kept my sister with me, and she, And then a couple of days later, they started, had a roll call, and they didn't tell us anything, but suddenly I saw forming details. And Danka was standing next to him because she didn't have for several days food. She got some food and she had diarrhea and asked the blocker, would she let her in to go in, and she didn't. And I shook the block elder a little bit. Didn't she have a brother or sister? So I was punished right away. SS woman walked up to me. She threw me on the ground, and she beat me up real good. And we marched out to work from Auschwitz I to a detail. And we worked with slave labor, with lorries. We sifted sand. Whatever could be sifted was wet, and it was raining. And loaded it up on lorries. I don't know if you know what a lorry is, iron things on wheels, which is supposed to go on railroad tracks. But we were pushing him, four on one side, four on the other side. And you had to watch out not to lose that shoe that was only with a strap, because you'd be punished, they said, if you lose that. So if I don't know what happened to the ones that lost, I didn't lose mine. And pushing up the lorry, emptying the center, coming back and sifting. And a couple of days or a week later, they told us to carry bricks from one place to another one, and about 10 bricks like this, and then it wasn't enough with this. And I had Danka always with me, okay, standing next to me. And they weren't satisfied with this, so they made for their pleasure the SS guard with us. There was a couple with us, is a German woman. I don't know, do you understand what the couple was? She was brought from a prison from Germany, serving a sentence for whatever reason. There are different three categories, but that's maybe not important to mention the categories. And she's a couple, and she's going to stay in camp. She's German, Reichsdeutsche, means she's Aryan. They stay in different buildings than we, already in Auschwitz I. They already had different buildings, and they had pillows, I think, and sheets and blankets. And we had just a straw-filled burlap sack on those beds, on those bunk beds, and a thin blanket, like a rack over it. So it. But anyway, we were still together, and then they made us throw, instead of carrying the blocks, they put us 6, 10 feet apart and throwing the blocks till you had to receive it with your hand till your hands were bleeding. And that was lasting till about September, I think, September. And then they, one morning we were lining up on roll call. Nobody ever told us. We were just like, maybe they, in the free world, you tell an animal more, somewhere directed, you're going this way. Just marched out, and we kept on marching, not to the field, we marched the other direction than the field before, than the detail. And in that other direction, we discovered when we came in, there were barracks there. It looked like stables. They were brick too, but practically no windows there in it. And we marched in and assigned to different barracks. And in the barracks were three shelves. And a wall here, and a wall here. And the shelves, wooden planks, and a little rack of a blanket there. And we started out with about six or so on one of those planks, six on one, the next second, six on another one. But then every single day, one more transfer, they marched us out for details to work with the same couple. The couple moved to Auschwitz too. This was the men's camp, and they didn't have the other buildings ready. So that's why we were in the men's camp, and they divided it with that wall. Then they took the wall away, and it remained a men's camp. And block 11 was the block of death. That's where they were making all the executions. While I was still in block 10, I heard shooting through the window. I was just on this bunk bed where the window was. And the window was boarded up. That was on the second floor. It was boarded up, and I looked through the openings between the window, and I saw on the wall opposite me, I saw soldiers standing in green uniforms, holding their hands like this, and then I heard a bullet. So the Germans were standing under my window. I couldn't see them, the SS. But I saw the soldiers there, and I discovered, I think, these must be the uniforms. And I asked later on, and I pulled through the window, shouted to him, and he threw me a note over. He said, yes, that was 12,000 of them were here. 7,000 are already dead, and you are wearing their uniforms. And 5,000 are periodically in block 11, shooting him every single day and killing them. That's how I found out. And then we went to Birkenau, and there in Birkenau were those shelves. And we were six first, but so many transports were coming in every single day. We ended up with 12 of us instead of in the length, hanging the feet hanging down and just there, and just with a rack of a blanket. And this is Birkenau.
Do you have an idea of when exactly you arrived in Birkenau?
Yes, it was, we came in March, and this was, what was September? either September or October. September or October, the same year. So we were from March, March, April, May, June, July. About 5 to 6 months we were in Auschwitz I.
Okay, and what year are we talking now that you got to Birkenau?
The same we started talking, 42. Because we came in March 42.
Okay, so it's
1942. Only it is October now. We ended up in Birkenau. And in Birkenau was the same thing, details going out on a lot harsher. The sleeping quarters and the beatings and things was getting, they were more cruel and more experienced every time more transports came, because they were using us for slave labor. I don't know how much useful it was, because those bricks throwing wasn't a useful job. So I said they're just waiting for us to die off, and then other ones. And they weren't very careful with it, which one they killed or whoever they killed, because they could be killed by a capo, it could be killed by the SS guard that was with us. We marched out with a capo that didn't have a, was wearing a striped dress like we. Oh, by the way, we got the, at one point in Birkenau, they took away the Russian uniforms and they changed us to burlap dresses. A long dress with long sleeves and buttoned up all along. And that for that year, the end of this year, the whole winter, we were just in that dress, without underwear, without anything, and just those wooden shoes, we were working again in the details, the same as the other ones before.
Did you try to get into any other detail, any work detail?
I didn't try to get in because, first place, I was Polish Jews and I didn't have any relatives or family. And all the Jewish there, the Jewish girls that had positions, were the first ones, the Slovakian. And the Slovakian girls were had their cousins, they had their sisters, and had their, and they gave them the positions. And even if I wanted to, and I could have to, I didn't want for another reason. They don't give you a position with two. Then I'm going to let my sister go out alone. She's never going. She went out once alone during the whole stay in Birkenau until we went somewhere else, and she was beaten up, almost half dead. Came back to March, and I thought for sure that. At night, from the details, they were carrying the dead, the ones that they shot or they killed or the dogs tore them apart. The girls, they had to carry him in, carrying the dead ones. And I was looking in the whole time while we were marching in. I saw every one of them I saw on the shoulders, two shoulders, two girls carrying. I saw there was my sister. But it wasn't. She was beaten up because she was late. They let him go to the latrine before marching into camp, and she was the last one coming out. I wasn't there to hold a hand. So she was. She wasn't very alert in camp. Okay, she was depending on me. That one day was a coincident, unpleasant one detail that isn't important. But she marched out with another commandos they were called, another detail, and wasn't with me. So she had the beating. Otherwise, I took the beatings usually, protecting her.
Okay. Were jobs assigned? Were you put in details? Were you able to line up in certain details?
How did it was that a roll call. Say we are now in Birkenau and there are already hundreds of us there. We're standing in rows of five like this. They're counting us in the morning. It's a roll call is 4 o'clock in the morning. The block elder and a room elder. Every block elder had an assistant. They called the room elder. They are using sticks to get you off the bed if you can't wake up. And they're beating you. Mm-hmm. So this is another reason that I didn't want to be a block elder or a room elder. I couldn't do that, so I wasn't going to be. I wasn't beaten very often because I was alert and awake, and the minute I woke up, I pulled my sister down and she was next to me. So everything that I could, I remember the words that I promised Mama, take care of your younger sister, take care of the Kleiner. And I did as much. And she cooperated very nicely with everything. And being that she was the youngest child and spoiled and babied and favored, I'm amazed how she could go through everything. And whatever happened, scabies or whatever, or later on malaria, she had it. I didn't have the scabies. I had a little bit itching on the fingers. She had it on her whole body, and I had to sell the portion of bread to get some salve to save her. But anyway, later on, they were choosing, in Auschwitz, they were choosing, Mengele was mostly the one choosing for different details, okay? And I knew only that Mengele had details, different kinds. He was shooting for other jobs too and everything. But I saw people, while we were marching out, other people, other girls like us, in the same uniform, only had a white apron with them, wearing too, were going somewhere doing something under the SS and under the capo doing something, but they looked terrible. They were skinny and the eyes were dead, just practically holes looking at them when we passed them by. And then I asked in the camp, you see, we didn't associate with anybody because you came in at 7 o'clock from where you stopped from work, 3 hours roll call. By the time you had the little piece of bread and a bowl of tea, plain tea, and drank it, you throw yourself on the plank and you fell asleep. There was no time. So they later on, sometimes if they had information, they would tell us something, the blockheld or the rumeled, but not very often. If they did, that's mostly to the Slovakian girls. So we were a little bit isolated, Danka and I, because we were from Polish. And by the way, I did not get the Have a Star of David on my tattoo. I had a tattoo, as you can see, the scar from where my number was removed. It's right here. This one dot is left. A Jewish doctor removed it. And he said he didn't want to cut it in crooked, he wanted a straight line, and that doesn't, nobody's going to bother me about it. He offered it to do it for me. And every Jewish girl there, everybody in camp, all the Jews, had a triangle, a half of a Jewish star, the triangle. And on the number two was a triangle. And I didn't have the triangle, I didn't have here, so I could have slept with the Gentiles in the other block if my sister wasn't there, and have better life maybe or something. I probably wouldn't have done it anyway. But anyway, this is what it was.
You were telling me about Mengele
choosing. So that one day Mengele is choosing, but I have no connection between Mengele and these people that I saw there. I have no idea who they are. So he's choosing 100 from roll call is over, and he said, you, 100 of them. From the 100, he chose 50. And Danka was not among these 50. So I sold my portion of bread to one of the other couples that I knew, the couple that was ours, her friend. So she saw me every day marching out with Emma, the other one, Erica was her name. I went to talk to Erica. Erica had the list. I said, do you have the list for those 50 people that we had chosen now? She said, yes. I said, I'm very close with my sister and I take care of her. She's my younger sister. Could you give me, scratch out somebody else's name and put me in? My sister in, and here's my portion of bread. I gave her the portion of bread, she scratched out the other name, the girl went, and Danka came in. A couple of days later, it's quarantine. And the quarantine, they gave us clean dresses again, and the white aprons. And a couple of days later, like 5-6 days later, we march out, 50 of us march out, but Danka is with me, so I'm not so worried, and I didn't pay attention to really what was going on. And while we are lined up, this is the roll call, the camp road, and opposite the camp road was a little building, just one room building, a brick building, and that was Mengele's office. Because when we came over there, we suddenly had to go into office, and there was a scribe there, and taking the names and the numbers, writing it down, at least I think so, all of them, all 50 of us, and Mengele wasn't there, and here our SS on this side is roll call, and we are on the other side, just the 50 separated. And there are 3 or 4 SS counting the people here. Nobody's counting us, we're just standing. And suddenly somebody comes out from behind the building, Mengele's building, with a sheet of paper and a pencil. And if you, anybody who had a sheet of paper and a pencil walking around while everybody else was local, was somebody, a prominent, either a blockhead there or had some function more than just the plain people like I was and Danka working in the field outside. And I see her pointing at somebody that she knew, and she called her, and I saw her getting in the paper and scratching something out, scratching her name out, and took her away, went behind the block. And I said to Danka, I said, guess what? I said, there was some of them that go to, there were some rumors that Mengele is doing sterilization and all kinds of other experiments, and she took out this one, and she's a prominent person. If she knew, we were happy to be in that detail because maybe finally, this is already so many months later, and we got another winter is coming, and we're going to be working outside. So we were happy we're going to be maybe somewhere under the roof, maybe in a sewing room or somewhere in a better detail. And I said, this could not be a good detail. And before that day, Danka was getting very depressed, and she sort of, even that little piece of bread, she almost didn't want to chew up. And I was getting worried about it, and I woke her up one day, and I said to her, Danka, what is it that you are acting differently than you did at the beginning? What can you act here? It's not worth living here. She said, this is not life. And I'm going to be, I said, then I'm in the same boat with you. No, you're not. You look a lot better than I. And if they're going to be chosen for that, they're going to choose me and not going to choose you. And I'm not afraid to die alone. I don't want you. I would be glad if you were alive. But I'm worried only about the trip to the gas chambers. I see how after the selections, by the way, in the meantime, selections are going on. They're choosing the weaker ones, but they think these weaker ones. Just putting the thumb this way, that was all life was worth there. And they're throwing out on flatbeds, throwing up those that are chosen to die. And she said, I saw them how they threw them out on those flatbeds, and it's horrible. It's just like rotten potatoes they do it. That's the way they treat them. She said, and I'm afraid of that. I said, okay, you give me your hand. I said, here is a holy book. And God is everywhere, I said. And mom and dad are standing right here. I swear to you, if I'm going to be chosen, I go with you. You're not going to be alone. We're going to die together. From that day on, she just wasn't a different person. She wanted to live again and stay with me.
Okay, let's take a break here and change tape. Okay, this is tape 5. We're interviewing Rena Gelissen. It's January 24th, 1996. We left off with the last tape. You were selected by Mengele for what you think are sterilization.
Yeah, the reason that I saw that person, she's an important person taking one person out. She must know it's not for the detail that you can save your life, but just to lose your life maybe. So I said to Danka, we are going, and she said, no, I'm afraid that everybody else is. I said, what difference does it make? I said, they're going to kill us anyway. If you're going for sterilization, then you're not going to live anyway, I said. And you're going to be a cripple before that and suffer. I said, you going with me? And she didn't say anything. So I grabbed her hand and pretended I'm a very important person, holding her hand. The SS running around and counting the others. I said, went in back of the SS, went to the building where we changed the clothes, found the clothes, the whole pile of clothes that we that morning that they changed us, and the aprons thrown off, put it on the bottom. Found it, but for 50 uniforms, found Danka's and mine, which has the number on it, so it had to be the same thing, Danka's dress and mine, and run outside the back door again, in back of the people, and they were lined up, and I asked, would you push up, move up a little bit, and they started counting all over again, because when one moves up, the other one moved out, and the whole row had to move out, or the whole camp road, but I didn't know who it was, and to this day, I don't know who saved my life, the person that came to pick out that one person saved our lives, because this was, I found out later, sterilization. Okay. And sterilization meant death, okay, after suffering.
Right. Mengele chose you for another detail later.
Yeah, later on, after so many selections, other ones, he came and chose again for another detail. And there was no choice. He chose 50 of us. Danka was among the 50. We did not go in the building for quarantine. 50 of us are marching out, having no idea where we're going. And most of the time I was thinking this is for that, already too, for whatever. And then we came into a building and it was the headquarters of the SS. And we ended up in the SS laundry, which definitely saved our lives. Because in that laundry, even if we worked outside, there were no electric wires, there were no guards with the machine guns on there. And the roll call was happening inside. Food was exactly the same, very little, a starvation diet, okay? But the circumstances were better. There was not an SS everywhere with a rifle running around. There were no dogs that we were terrified of it. And And there was no wires around walls around the camp. This was one building going behind an SS kitchen to another building. In back of the building were closed lines, and I was chosen. The SS woman asked who speaks German, and I said I do. And she chose me to hang out the clothes outside. And with hanging out the clothes outside, and with living there, and roll call on the inside, and there was one shower that once a month we could take a shower. The first time after, this is 2 years later, almost 2 years later. And this helped a little bit. The food was the same, the portions were small, but there were no beatings. If you did something wrong, there could have been. So if they would catch us with something doing wrong, there could have been beatings, and I could have been back to Birkenau.
Do you know when you were sent to the laundry? Do you have any idea
yes,
of the date?
Yes, there was also October 1943.
And how long did you work in the laundry?
I worked in the laundry all the way till the death march.
Can you tell me about that?
Yeah. We worked in the laundry in the staff quarters. They had two floors up, and we were in the basement. I was working. And then suddenly there were rumors that the Russians are coming closer, and they're going to lose the war. The Germans are going to lose the war. And when a couple of weeks later, they moved us. They moved I don't know where their people were, the officers, where they went, from the two floors above us. But we were moved to a leather factory and to new blocks, they called. Again, that we were sifting sand. Remember, that was for new blocks, that they're building more of them. We moved in the new blocks, and in the morning, an SS woman was taking goods out to go. You see, and the first laundry, there wasn't an SS one because it was just near the drying place. The Trockenplatz was near. But this one was farther to the leather factory, and they took us out there every single day. And one of the days they were taking us, we worked almost a year there, but in 1945, we heard some rumors that there was some girl. We heard some rumors they're going to blow up a crematorium, and one day in October, I think 45, this is a year later. No, this is 44. The crematorium was a big detonation we had, and they were supposed to save their lives, the men that worked in the Sonderkommando. But anyway, it's a long story. Four Jewish girls participated in it, and they were arrested. And we were first very joyful that the crematoriums are going to be broken up. But then when we heard the four girls were arrested and they're going to be hanged, and then the SS woman took us to the camp to Birkenau again. We are not in Birkenau. Those new blocks are not in Birkenau either. That's a separate camp again, without so much wires and walls than it was in Birkenau and in Auschwitz one. So we went to Birkenau and had to line up, and orders were really shouting loud. The officers, straight looking at the gallows, we had to look where the girls are going to be hanged, and the four girls were marched in, and they stepped on the chairs, and they were singing Hebrew songs, and did I go? Okay. And we had to keep the eyes open, otherwise we're going to be shot. And then the SS woman brought us back to our quarters, to the laundry again, after they killed the girls, and she made us sing German songs on the way home, on the way there, and on the way back to the laundry. Then was the SS laundry, and then we had rumors again the Russians are really coming close. And then one day the from the men's camp, I received a letter. I had on the drying place, I met a man that worked in the men's commando, and he sent me a note with the people that brought the tea. From the men's camp, the people were brought in from the kitchen, SS, from the camp kitchen. They were bringing to the women's camp the tea and the bread. And he sent me a note, that Jewish boy, that they're going to march out people. They already started. And this was like the 16, I think, or something, or the 17. So I received a note that he's going to send me some, to send him a note back with these people and to tell him how many people I have in my group that I like. I said, in addition to Danka and me, and I told him six of us. And he sent pants and shoes and socks and six loaves of bread and some cubes of sugar. He sent to it with the kettle. One kettle was empty. instead of the tea in it, they risked their life, those were Gentiles, the ones that brought in the tea, risked their life to having that kettle, the food and the clothes for us. And then we marched out on the death march. And January 18, 1 o'clock at night, the generator, he also sent a watch with him that I, my memorabilia I have from Marek, that watch. And we started marching, and sometimes we heard the detonations from the Russians coming, but we had no choice. They dragged us along, and the sick could stay behind. And you could hide, maybe hide with the sick staying behind, but then the rumors were going, they're going to set a fire at the camp from all sides. So you couldn't win either way. So while we were marching, there were dead people. It was the worst snowstorm in many, many years. So I'm marching in the deep snow, without food, without drink, only what we had from the pack. In 2 days, the food was gone. What we had was 6 loaves of bread. We just divided it, and it was gone. And once in a while, they let us stop in a barn in the Polish farmers. This is Poland that we are going to, because Auschwitz is Poland too. We're going towards the German border. And on one of those trips, I started getting sore feet, had blisters on the feet, and I had diarrhea. And I was really getting, I said, after Auschwitz, to have this one, and it doesn't look like we're going to be alive. Because if you just slipped or something, or went out of line, you already got the bullet. And when they fell down, you don't know if they're dead, how long they're going to be suffering there. So I decided that I saw a day before a girl go into an outhouse. You know how farmers have an outhouse? Go in. And we were already lined up, and she didn't come out. So the SS opened up the door and saw it there and gave shot her. And then I saw her roll out of that. I decided this seems to me like an easier death than walking to that much. So I was going to abandon Danka and went in. And then before I had a chance to do it, she and another friend from the group of six walked by it, opened the door and dragged me out of there, and weren't supposed to hold anybody or support, but they supported me under the elbows, holding me. And 2 hours or 3 hours later, I was a different person. The feet weren't hurting so much. I have no idea why. Maybe the encouragement of Danka being so terrified, and the other friend, and I was going to abandon her, and I suddenly realized I made a promise and I'm not keeping it. So I almost broke it. And so I went along and I felt better. And then we went put into trains, and from the trains they dragged us in the middle of nowhere, and then we walked again 3 hours that next day or the third day, I don't remember what it was. And we ended up in Ravensbrück that was all full of women. They had some brought in from the Warsaw Uprising, some women that were fighting in that uprising. So all the beds, everything was there. So we had on the dirt floor, we were sleeping that night and a couple of nights, and there was practically no food. But a week later, they came to pick us up with military trucks again and brought us to the last camp, to Neustadt-Glewe.
Were you liberated from that camp?
We were liberated from that camp by the 82nd, I just recently found out, by the 82nd Airborne Division, stationed right there in North Carolina where I live now. So they were liberated, and the Russians came at the same time too there. But then they formed the Ludwigslust is a bigger city, and they formed where the Americans pulled back 5 miles, and there was no man's land in between, and the Russians stayed behind. And we decided, instead of going home, what I promised my mom, I finally realized or allowed myself to realize that the promise that I made, that I'm going to bring it home to mama, mama's going to open the door and say, I brought your baby back, that this is not going to happen. I said, why don't we just go? So 10 of us decided to try to get, there was already a soldier there checking for passes, but we passed by the soldier by telling him some story that I made up. And we went to the other side, and we went to the Americans. And then the Americans wouldn't let us in because they didn't know who we were. We didn't speak the English language. Only one of us spoke. And they thought we may be spies or something. So they went to get the major, and the major brought us into a big, beautiful villa, a mansion. And the owners of the villa, of the mansion, were gone, and just the housekeeper was there. Ordered the housekeeper, he's going to bring us bread and cheese, he's going to bring us everything that we need, and she's supposed to serve us breakfast in bed. So we stayed there a couple of days there in that mansion, and then we had to go to the displaced person camp, because near Ludwigslust were about 20 little camps around there, and the Americans were getting crazy to have different people anyway. He said, I can't do it any longer, have you here. We have to be concentrated in one building and bringing you where you want to. So he made sure that one of the military trucks brought us to the Netherlands.
So were you in a DP camp?
Yes, yes. It was an empty school building.
Okay.
During the war, they weren't going to the school there, and okay. Especially when the Allies were marching in. So the Germans left the school building there in Ludwigslust. So the school building was used for us, and we slept there.
Can you tell me how you met your husband?
Yes. They brought us to the Netherlands. We decided among us that we'd go to the Netherlands, the six of us. The other ones, from the other four that were there, they decided something else, to go to France, I think. And with the six of us, decided to Netherlands, they dropped us off at the hospital because at the border, they did not want to let us in if we had any contagious diseases or any serious diseases. So they kept us for 3 days in quarantine at the hospital and checked our lungs and everything. And miracle of miracles, everything was okay. All six of us were left into the country. And first they were going to send us back to Germany, but that's a long story. And I begged the major off to send us. I said, why don't you just kill us if you want to send us back to Germany? We had enough of it. So I said, I don't know what to do with you. He said, I tell you what I do. You're begging so much. My cars from here, my military trucks, are bringing in Gentile prisoners of war that they took, not prisoners of war, that they took people, Dutch people, civilians they took while they were fighting on the front and losing a lot of people. They replaced them with Dutch people, but taken by force, and they were returning. So I'm going to just sneak you in among that. And when we came in, there were relief teams, and John Gillison was the head of one of the relief teams, the captain of it. And we came into his camp, and that he processed the other people. And the bridges, there's a lot of water in the Netherlands, and there were a lot of bridges broken. So he had to disinfect the people, feed them, and then give them transportation to bring them to their homes. But they had passports, they had papers. There were citizens of there, and there were Gentiles. And he didn't know what to do with five of us there. And one of them we lost in the military compound. We didn't know where she was, and she later got herself to France, and she lives in France. But the five of us came into his camp. So after we were there a whole week, said, what are we going to do? They have no papers, no identification. So he took us to the police station and registered us by names, what we told them, who we were. And he put his name down and signed it that he's guaranteeing for it, vouching for us, for the five Jewish girls there. And we stayed in the Red Cross, and he employed us, asked us for the talents, what we have. So I said, I know how to sew. So Danka and I did sewing. Two of them did dusting, and one worked in the kitchen. So as long as the camp lasted, the people were coming back from Germany, he was still there, and we were helping there. And we were getting a salary, too, from the allies, from either the British or the Canadians, I think.
When did you marry?
He started being very nice to us, brought us back. He brought us back to the normal world again. We were hiding bread in a suitcase in the everything that's left over from food. We were helping with the cleaning up after the meals too. We were hiding in a suitcase, and one of the nurses there, he had a staff of people. He had people working for him, nurses and chauffeurs that were driving the people back with the cars that he had to their homes. And one of them found out and went to the commander. He was the commander of the team, and told him. And he made all the arrangements with me because I was the only one that spoke German again. So while we were speaking, that we were talking about other things too. He started flirting with me, and he decided they were socializing with other Red Cross camps in the neighborhood, and they had dances. He decided to take us to the dances there too, and he brought us into life again. And treating us like ladies, and he was the gentleman.
So again, when did you get
and
married?
And then 2 years later.
Okay.
When the camps were over, we went. He came and picked us up. We were going first to a hachshara. After the camps were over, he brought us with his trucks and cars. Brought us to he found out that in one city was a building, and there were Jewish people, survivors that came back, are working there. And they're working just like Hashara in Israel, and they're waiting to get to Israel when the borders are free, when the British are going to give up and not arrest everybody that's going there. And then John came back, and one day he pretended that he came with a friend of his by a motorcycle, went for business there, and he came by with him. So he came to talk to me. And then the next time when he came, he said he would want us to come there. Why do we stay here? His cook is going to take us into his house. And he took us in there to his house. And then we got to know each other better. And 2 years later, we were married in 47.
Okay. When did you come to the United States?
We came in 1954.
Okay. You have children?
Yes, four children. Oldest daughter, Sylvia, and the second one is Joseph, and the third one is Peter, and the fourth one is Robert, the only one who's born in the United States, and he can become president. The other ones can't.
Okay. What kinds of occupations did you have when you came to this country?
Well, I had occupation being housewife and mother for the three children. I had three at that time. One of them was born in the United States. And John was a physical education professor, a college professor. He already taught physical education in Europe. But because the physical education in Europe is a completely different position, when we came to America, they wanted him to be a coach. And he was going to travel all over the country with the people, and he didn't want to do that. So he went, took courses at a university that took courses while he got a position as a teacher, as a professor in Biddeford, Maine. At the same time, he was traveling to Massachusetts to study. And to change that into, because he had already physical education, a lot of biology, he started changed it and studied biology, and he graduated and was since then a biology professor. Okay. And he taught German and Latin too, by the way. He was qualified to teach those subjects. I shouldn't cut it short. I wanted to brag about it.
That's okay.
If you don't mind.
It's fine.
And he deserves it.
I know you wrote a book.
Yes.
And you're doing an interview with us now. Can you tell me why you wrote the book, why you're doing the interview? Is there some message that you want to give future generations?
Yes. I promised myself when I was still in Auschwitz, I already started thinking about, as I told you, from a little town I was naive, so I had my way of thinking was a little bit different than the world is like. I promised myself when I come out, I'm going to tell the world what happened, that they were throwing in children into the gas chambers and into the fires, and what they did. And maybe if I write a book, and maybe some people are going to find out there's never going to be a war again. If they hear what was happened, how could they have a war again? Well, this didn't happen because people didn't listen very much for 50 years. But I had that message, and I wanted to give it anyway. I gave up already, actually. But then I met a friend that has another friend that could write, and she told me, you are in Auschwitz, you should write a book about it. I said, I didn't find anybody that can write. I have just the person for you. And that was Heather McAdam, the person. I said, how old is that person? 32. I said, oh, come on, she's a baby. What does she know about Jews and about the Holocaust in Europe? She lives in America, born in America. I promise you, she knows everything about it. She happened to be very much interested in Holocaust history. I said, okay, we met, and the book was written to honor my parents' memory. I got to watch it now because the tears come. And to speak for the 6 million Jews that can't speak for themselves. Okay, was it.
Is there any message that you'd like to give for your children and your grandchildren?
To spread the word what happened so it never happens again. Maybe, just maybe. Seeing what all goes on, I don't know how much I accomplished with it. But if I just accomplished a little bit, I'm going to be happy with it.
Thank you. All right. Ms. Gelissen, would you please introduce us to your family here?
This is my oldest daughter, Sylvia, next to me. And next to her is my husband and her father, John Gelissen.
Sylvia, was there something you wanted to say?
Yes, that I'm very happy to say at the least that my mother made it through this experience, because otherwise I wouldn't be here, nor my three brothers, nor my two nephews, nor my niece. And her surviving has also acted as a situation that I can follow in my own life when I need strength and courage.
Thank you.
What's this picture?
In Czechoslovakia, I think, when she was married. I don't know if it was...
So tell us, what's this picture now?
Yeah. Okay. This is my beautiful mama, and I think the picture was taken where she was born, in Petrova, Czechoslovakia, and either a wedding picture or right after the wedding, because she looks very young.
And what's this picture?
This picture is of the family, made specially for my older sister that was in the U.S. at that time. And Mama wanted to feel that she is at home to see the picture. From left to right is the youngest sister, Danka. Then is Mama. And then is...
And your mother's name? First name?
Sarah. And then is the second sister, after the one that is in America, Gertrude, is Zosia, and she was 14 years older than I was, and Gertrude 16 years older. And the next is Papa, next to the older sister. And then the last one on the right-hand side, that's myself, Rena.
And do you know when this was taken, or approximately?
Yes. I was about 6 years old, and I'm 75 now. So you want to do the figuring, or should I?
Do you know where it was taken?
Yes, in a resort, where you have to drive there to the photographer, in Krynica.
And what's this picture?
This picture is of my hometown, Tillich, located in the Carpathian Mountains in the south of Poland.
And what's this picture?
This picture is approximately a third grade picture for Danka, for my sister Danka, and a cousin is standing right next to her, Tsivia. And they were the same age, I think. And I was in fifth grade then, and I think I was standing somewhere in the back. I'm not visible. And the two teachers, the late teacher and the nun.
And where was it taken?
In my hometown, Tillich. In the middle of the picture is, on the left side, my cousin, Tsivia Kornreich, and on the right side is Danka Kornreich, my sister, and it's taken at school in Tillich.
And what's this picture?
This picture is, again, the same as the other picture, only the teachers allowed the boys to be in it, too. And it's, again, Danka and Sylvia, and more to the right. The second... Okay. On the right-hand side is my sister Danka, my younger sister, and next to it, my cousin Sylvia.
What's this picture?
This picture is myself on the right-hand side, about 16... And on the left-hand side, Danka, my younger sister. And in the middle is Dina Goldberger, and she lives in France. All three of us survived Auschwitz. And the bear is a man that dressed as a bear to earn some money in the winter months. And his buddy took the picture.
And who's this?
This is a friend of mine, a childhood friend. He is here now, growing up. He was a pilot. And later on, during the war, he was... working for the underground, and he saved my life by bringing me also from Poland, from danger, to Czechoslovakia. He's from my hometown, Tillich, and his name was Andrzej Garbera. He died on this job doing the underground work.
And what's his picture?
This is a picture of myself, you can see by the sad eyes, after I survived Auschwitz about 3 months later, taken in the Netherlands, when we came in after the war.
And what year was it taken?
In 1945.
And what's this picture?
This is my sister Danka and I, about 6 months or almost a year, I think. So it's 1946, maybe. And
who's on the left?
On the left is my younger sister Danka, and we both had new dresses, so we made a nice picture for it. And we were recovered from Auschwitz.
And that's you on the right?
Yes, I'm on the right. Sorry. And this is myself on the right. And on the left, John Gelissen. This is our wedding picture on July 29, 1947.
What's this picture?
Okay, this picture is the last picture before we came to the United States. We came to U.S. in 1954, and this is with the three children, Sylvia on the left side with her doll, Joseph in the middle, and Peter in my arms. And my husband in the background.
What's this picture?
This is a family picture taken with children, our children and spouses. It's taken, I think, to honor the 75th birthday of my husband, John Gelissen. And let's see. Was the 75th? Yes, it was the 75th birthday. And next to him is our son-in-law, Jim, and our daughter, Sylvia. And then it's... Is the baby there? Do you see the baby there? The baby granddaughter, Julia, and myself in the center, and Julia's mother, my daughter-in-law, Claire, and her husband, my son, Robert, and then my other daughter-in-law, Lori, and at the end of it, my son, Peter.
What's this?
This is my book, A Dream Come True, A 50 Years Dream Come True. I was dreaming about to write down whatever what happened to us during World War II and my family. And the cover picture is in the center my older sister. On the right of her, my father, and on the left of her, my mother, and my younger, and next to my mother, my younger sister, Danka, and the right-hand side in the corner is myself, Rena.